Actions. It only takes one voice to make a difference, and tonight WFMZ's Chandy Laurie tells the story of how thousands of young voices at Lafayette College spoke up for one of their classmates that made people stop and think while making a mark in history.
The year was 1948, and Lafayette College was having a football season good enough to get an invite to one of the biggest bowl games of the time, the Sun Bowl in El Paso, Texas. But you'll find no mementos from that game here in Lafayette's trophy case or anywhere on the Eastern campus, because the Leopards didn't play.
The Lafayette students went nuts. Why not? What do you mean we're not going to play in the Sun Bowl?
Diane Shaw, who works at the college, says the school voted not to go to the game. The college never publicly named a reason why. But the reason did have a name. David Showell.
He was part of the reason why the team won the bid in the first place.
He was Lafayette's star halfback, an excellent student, an Army veteran, and Tuskegee Airmen in World War II. But he wasn't good enough in some people's eyes because his skin was darker than their skin.
They weren't going to allow a black player to actually play the game.
The stadium was state-owned and segregated, and during that time in our country, African Americans were restricted from the basic rights of being an American. One player I spoke with who was on the Lafayette football team with David says they weren't just athletes, they were a family. So David told his teammates to go without him.
It's an honor, it's a privilege. We've all worked hard, go ahead and play. Don't worry about me.
But Lafayette voted not to go. Shaw says the students became rowdy, lit a bonfire, and went to the president's house to demand an answer. But when he told them David was not allowed to play in the game, their rage shifted.
And they took all that anger and distress that they had originally were directing at the president toward the Sun Bowl officials.
Lafayette students refused to stand by in silence and let others hate speak for them.
They stormed the Western Union office downtown. They sent a telegram to President Harry Truman, which read, "Denied Sun Bowl because we have a black player. Is this democracy?"
The students went to journalists until this pivotal moment in history spread through the nation. They also wrote a resolution to be passed the next day at a civil rights rally held on campus.
"We protest the racial discrimination against one of our fellow students."
David was one of two black students the college had admitted in a century, but thousands attended the rally.
I think this may have been one of the earliest student civil rights rallies to happen in America.
Although David died at the age of 31 in a truck accident while he was visiting Philadelphia on Christmas break from law school, his family says all that he learned from his father and accomplished during a time when people tried to hold him back has not been forgotten.
I cried because I'm like, oh my God, here's a guy I never met, but he's part of my life. He's part of my motivation. I've heard about him my whole entire life. Thank God he did all that he did, because it was part of the motivation for all of us.
Pioneers in football like Bill Willis and Tony Dungy have broken racial barriers and have motivated others to change collegiate and professional football. Draylen James plays on the Lafayette football team and has studied the sociology of sports. James says we have definitely moved toward a much better society where African Americans are seen as equal in football, but inequality still exists and stigmas need to be erased.
African Americans can't play the sort of positions in the NFL, or in sports like quarterback.
I talked with a former NFL quarterback who has more than a decade of experience. He agrees that stigma exists for black quarterbacks as well as coaches. Those viewpoints can be found inside and outside locker rooms. For some, this may be something someone would have written in the 1940s during segregation. But no, it's from this year. And while researching this story, someone used the N-word in conversation with me. So maybe we could go back to 1948 and learn something in 2016 from the little college who took a big stand.
Before standing together to win the greatest game they never played.
Chandy Laurie, 69 News.